From Iron Man's repulsor technology to Doc Brown's mystery fusion and Back to the Future, the vision of clean, efficient, powerful jet thrusters has always maintained strong in the world of science fiction. But what if that vision became reality? With plasma engines, the world of science fiction may not be too far away. But what are plasma engines? How do they work? And can they really allow us to fly further and faster, all while emitting no emissions? We thought these questions deserved a deeper dive today on Two Bit da Vinci. Special thanks to Anker for sponsoring this video. Check out the compact Anker Nano Pro for your various USB charging needs. Over the last two decades, electric vehicle makers like Tesla have completely altered the auto industry, changing the conversation around energy-efficient technology. This, of course, begs the question, what other industries might benefit from an eco-friendly overhaul? How about air travel? According to the U.S. Environmental Protection Agency, aircraft add about 12% of transport-related carbon emissions in the U.S., 3% of the nation's total greenhouse gases. Globally, aviation contributed just over 2% of total emissions in 2018. Considering 2018 saw a global increase of roughly 720 million metric tons of CO2, that's over 14 million metric tons from aircraft alone, over one-tenth of Manhattan. With plasma engines, that number could be drastically reduced to practically nothing. That's, of course, if they can get off the ground. So what is a plasma engine? To help understand the very sci-fi sounding technology, let's first look at regular old gas turbine engines. Now, jet engines are pretty complicated, but here's a quick rundown. Two common types are turbojet engines and turbofan engines. In a turbojet engine, an inlet ingests air, compresses it, and mixes it with fuel. The mixture then ignites, much like a car's internal combustion engine. This high-pressure, high-energy gas gets shot out a turbine that powers the first stage of the inlet and compressor. Yeah, it's a chicken or the egg situation, and that's why jet engines need some external help to get started. The rest of the air is shot out the back of the aircraft, producing thrust. Turbojets are typically more high performance, but less fuel efficient, and that's why commercial airliners use turbofan engines. In a turbofan, there's an additional large fan in the front sucking in air, but some of that air doesn't actually go into the heart of the engine. Instead, it's bypassed and just shoots out the back. The amount of air that enters the compressor and combustion chamber determines if the engine is a high bypass or low bypass turbofan engine. The more air that's bypassed, the less thrust you'll make, but you'll use less fuel, which means better fuel economy below the speed of sound. If you'd like us to cover more aircraft topic, write to me in the comment section. Nothing would make me happier. You know what ignites our engines? Hit that like button. A plasma engine is completely different. Instead of fuel and compressed air exploding out the back, a plasma engine uses microwave radiation to energize, compress, and excite gas molecules, such as air or argon, to transform electricity into plasma. Now, the word plasma might conjure up images of plasma casters from Fallout or Alien vs. Predator, but plasma is a very real thing. Like solids, liquids, or gases, plasma is a normal state of matter. It happens as molecules are heated up and ionized, essentially having their charge changed by either gaining or losing electrons, which is why plasma engines are sometimes called ion thrusters. The best part is that the thrusters don't require massive fuel tanks and they produce zero emissions. I know, this sounds like a bit more fiction than science, but we promise, these are real, and actually, they've seen quite a bit of action. NASA has employed plasma thrusters in a number of space vehicles, including Deep Space One craft and the Dawn asteroid probe. Space is the ideal environment for plasma engines. They consume less propellant than traditional thrusters and have a much higher specific impulse value, basically how efficiently they create thrust, than other rocket technology. Research shows that plasma thrusters are able to reach incredibly high speeds over extended acceleration. In fact, physicist and ex-astronaut Franklin Chang Diaz claims that some plasma thrusters could reach a maximum velocity of 34 miles per second and reach Mars in as little as 39 days. Before we get back to the show, let me tell you about one of our go-to brands and sponsor of this video, Anker. Our company runs on Anker. All of our USB charging hubs, our laptop docks, our battery banks for travel, and even most of our cables are from Anker. And this little fella is the Anker Nano Pro 20-watt USB charger. If you bought a new iPhone 13 only to discover that there is no charger in the box, this is for you. The Anker Nano Pro is super compact, 45% smaller than Apple's 20-watt charger, and it's even smaller than Apple's 5-watt charger while charging an iPhone 12 from 0 to 50% in just 26 minutes. And because it's USB-C, with the right cables, I can charge my iPhone, iPad, and MacBook Pro all with just this. Their active shield safety system means the charger is constantly monitoring temperatures and output to keep all your devices safe. It even comes in 4 fresh colors. So join the over 65 million Anker users around the world and see why we love this company so much by checking out the Nano Pro. Link in the video description. Huge thanks to all of you and Anker for making this show possible. But while the vacuum of space has proven ideal for the low propulsion of plasma engines, utilizing their capabilities on Earth, where we have, you know, an atmosphere and air, has proven a bit more challenging. Still, a number of researchers have made some pretty big leaps in recent years, leading some to believe that plasma engine technology may find its way to Earthbound aviation in the not-so-distant future. Leading the way is a team of researchers from Wuhan University in China, led by physicist Dr. Zhao Tang. Tang's prototype uses a compressor that forces air into an ionization chamber, which uses microwaves generated by a 1 kilowatt 2.45 gigahertz magnetron to convert this airstream into a plasma jet and gets blasted out of a quartz tube. The plasma reaches temperatures over 1,000 degrees Celsius, about as hot as molten lava. This method differs from other plasma jet thrusters in one key way. NASA's Dawn space probe, for instance, uses xenon plasma, which cannot overcome the friction in Earth's atmosphere, not powerful enough for air transportation. Tang's thrusters generate high-temperature, high-pressure plasma using only injected air and electricity. So what does all this sciencey stuff amount to? Well, the big breakthrough is that Tang's prototype was able to generate about 10 newtons of thrust at 400 watts using 0.5 liters per second for the airflow to lift a 1 kilogram steel ball. Now that might not sound super exciting, but according to Tang, if his device was scaled up, it could produce the corresponding thrusting pressure of a commercial jet engine. Another major breakthrough is happening at the Technical University of Berlin, where Burkhard Göksel, founder and CEO of Electrofluid Systems, and his team have tested a plasma thruster that can operate on air at a pressure of 1 atmosphere. That's the Earth's atmosphere at sea level. This prototype uses a rapid stream of nanosecond-long electric discharge to fire up the propulsion mixture. A similar technique is used in pulse detonation combustion engines, making them more efficient than standard fuel-powered engines. These breakthroughs mark serious progress in an area of technology that researchers have been chasing for decades. At least in laboratory environments, we're seeing plasma thrusters that can, at the very least, begin to match the thrust of today's jet engines. But before we start seeing jets zipping around like something out of Star Trek, there are a handful of notable hurdles that researchers need to clear. One major obstacle is scale. Tang's prototype, as we mentioned, was able to lift a 1 kilogram ball. Lifting something like an aircraft, that's a much bigger challenge. Göksel's team tested a mini thruster 80 millimeters long. For the same technology to work in a commercial aircraft, they would need about 10,000 of these thrusters. Of course, bigger thrusters would work too, but with large scale comes a series of other issues. So even though plasma engines don't need fuel, they still need a power source. Iron Man's repulsors are powered by the arc reactor. Doc Brown's flying DeLorean was powered by garbage. But sadly, once again, the world of science doesn't have quite as many answers as a world of science fiction. At least, not yet. Finding lightweight batteries that can produce the power requirements of these reactors has proven challenging. Build batteries too heavy and you create a bit of a paradox. More weight means more thrust required, which then needs more power. For plasma engines to really take off, we're gonna need some major energy breakthroughs. If you watch our channel at all, you know we're always talking about batteries, and well, yeah, this is why. Other power options include solar arrays and even compact fusion reactors. One idea actually involves beaming power to the engine wirelessly using lasers, fiber optic cables, and massive balloons. This is actually not a joke. But none of these technologies are even close to ready for plasma jet applications. Still, even with these setbacks, Tang believes we may see his prototype out in the field in smaller capacities within the next 5 to 10 years. Seemingly, everything is always 5 to 10 years away. But if the underlying energy source is batteries and we have propeller-driven aircraft already, You might be asking, why do we need plasma jet engines at all? Well, most propeller aircraft have a max speed of about 200 to 300 miles an hour. There are some high-performance prop planes out there, but hardly the sort of thing you'd use for commercial aviation. I always say, if you want some new, cleaner technology to replace the incumbent, it has to be better in pretty much every way. Zero emissions are great, but most people aren't going to be happy with flights that are half the speed and take twice as long. So a six-hour flight from New York to Los Angeles suddenly becomes 12. I have a four-year-old and a one-year-old, and let's say I'm going to hold out for the plasma jet thing. So who knows, maybe they'll allow us to fly even faster than current jets, just below the speed of sound, or a whole new chapter of supersonic flight. So while we may not see plasma jet engines in the immediate future, the need for zero emissions aircraft will continue to drive breakthroughs like these. But let us know what you think about the plasma jet thrusters. Is this sci-fi sounding tech too good to be true? Or are you hopeful that these breakthroughs will actually lead to real world applications in the near future? Sound off in the comments below. All right, that is a look at the plasma thruster. It is a really cool breakthrough, and I'm not gonna lie, it is years away, but it is a look at what might be possible in the near future. But remember that whatever we come up with, it will still need a battery or storage medium. Maybe compressed hydrogen batteries, we don't know. But this is why I always talk about how energy storage really sets at the center of every breakthrough. Better laptops, better cell phones, longer lasting. It's all gonna need batteries. But this would be pretty awesome, and I'm really hoping in my lifetime I could see a flight on a plasma jet airliner. That'd be pretty freaking cool. All right, so thank you so much for watching. As always, if you want to be a rock star supporter of this show, consider joining us on Patreon or as a YouTube channel member. We call you guys the 2-Bit Tribe. Come chat with us on Discord, help us research new topics, write scripts, even come join us on future trips and travel, all by just becoming a member. There's no long-term commitments, and we'd love to have you on board. You'll get to meet like-minded people like yourself, most likely. And thank you so much for watching. Take a look around. We have some other videos that we think you will love. And until next time, I'm Ricky with Two Bit da Vinci. And just remember, the future is going to be awesome.